Good evening and welcome. My name is Lori Thomas. I'm a first-year fiction writer. We're very thrilled to host Rion Amilcar Scott, the Zell Visiting Author in Fiction, for this evening's reading. My first encounter with the Rion Amilcar Scott work of fiction began with a suicide attempt. Rashid, a black man hanging from a noose, to be specific. In Scott's first story collection, protagonist Walter rescues his neighbor Rashid from what Rashid insists was an accidental fall off a railing, but to which the older, wiser Walter insists he can't be fooled. This is possibly because Rashid is in many ways a younger version of Walter, one which he narrowly escaped and for which cutting down his neighbor slides open a once-shut door. Two black men connected by a rope. This story is titled Good Times. The title references the iconic 1970s black sitcom that Walter watches to forget himself. For anyone who's familiar with the show, if you're not, you should check it out. Good Times slept on a pull-out couch next to some very bad times. So tragedy and humor in black life butting up against each other. Welcome to Cross River, the fictional small town where Scott's stories are set. Provocative, profane, spiritual, bizarre, and black. A town so vast, it spans two story collections. The first being Scott's debut, Insurrections, and the second, most recent collection, The World Doesn't Require You. Cross River exists at the coordinates of an alternate history, a town founded by the survivors of America's only successful slave revolt. It's a place that holds its own mythologies, false hopes, forgotten language, fallen legends, and musical sound. A modern-day black community inspired by the Haitian Revolution. One of the central questions Scott asks us to imagine is what becomes of the children of the insurrection. Scott's work holds the answer, if we're willing to see. In the story titled Confirmation from Insurrections, a young protagonist, Bobby, asks of his upcoming religious ceremony, "I wondered who'd I be stepping into adulthood with." The book asks the same of many of its cross riverians caught at that threshold. Who are we stepping into maturity with? As with Bobby, Rashid, and Walter, Scott takes us to the precipice of the harshest life lessons, the hard truths, washed in a dark humor. If the project of Insurrections establishes cross-riverian children becoming adults, adults putting away childish things, then Scott's second collection, The World Doesn't Require You, pushes cross-riverians off the cliff and into the absurdities of living on the edge of history. Here, the struggle in the present is to make meaning out of the terrible past, to communicate something out of the raw material that is Cross River history. The very real satire and magical realism that can be found in racism in black American life. In the opening story, David Sherman, the last son of God, God's son goes on an obsessive search for the notes that make river beat, the Cross Riverian sound. In another, a teacher abandons his serious work to play childhood games from a dark, rebellious past. And a robot slave attempts to deprogram himself. We get the sense cross riverians or river babies are on their own. Fraught, they crisscross Cross River in an elliptical search of something unrealized about themselves. To quote God's son, "And God faded away, but the water played a music, rhythm, like David had never heard." This evening, let Mr. Scott sway you with the rhythms of Riverbeat, the cunning language, and the devastating stories at the heart of Cross River. Good times indeed. Rion Amilcar Scott's work has been published in The New Yorker, Kenyon Review, The Rumpus, among others. He has received a notable mention in Best American Essays 2015 and Best American Stories 2018. Insurrections, published in 2016, won the Penn Bingham Award for debut fiction, and the 2017 Hillsdale Award from the Fellowship of Southern Writers. His second collection, The World Doesn't Require You, published in the summer of 2019, is a 2020 Penn Jean Stein Book Award finalist. It's my great pleasure and honor to welcome our very special guest, Rion Amilcar Scott.
Light that's kind of flashing across the screen, and it's a bit distracting, so if that's you, please turn it off. Thank you. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. How's everybody? I can't see you guys. Oh, there you are. Okay. All right. I'm going to read a little bit from The World Doesn't Require You. I'm going to read two sections. One from a story called The Temple of Practical Arts and one on a story called The Occasion of the Death of Freddie Lee. As you heard, all these stories take place in the fictional town of Cross River, Maryland, and that was founded after a slave revolt in 1807. So in The Temple of Practical Arts, it's about a group of people who live on this commune that they've squatted in an abandoned plantation. And there's a string of them on the edge of Cross River called the Ruins. And at this particular ruin, at all the various ruins, people go and they learn different things. And one ruin, they're learning the art of slapboxing here. They're learning Riverbeat, the town's indigenous music. So I guess that's all you need to know about this particular story. Before I read, I want to take a moment to dedicate this reading to my mother, Monica Scott, who passed away in March. She was the first person who encouraged me to write. So without her, you would have another writer standing up here, and she didn't get a chance to see this book. So I wanted to invite her into this space with us now. The kid's car pulled up in front of the temple one starless night when the sky appeared vast and dark. I was sitting on the porch when his golden car grumbled in. On security duty, it was my job to eye passing cars as suspiciously as people in Cross River and Port Yuga eyed us. The wrong balance of thing, of people, could topple the serenity of the new history we were building. The deity's wife stood leaning into the doorway, peeling an orange, enjoying fully the early summer warmth. She wore shorts so short, when I stood behind her, I thought I could see the beginning of a curve. But I may have just been imagining that. I could never figure the truth of her flesh from the fantasy of it. I rose and approached the car. The man who stepped out of the Honda wore wrinkled clothes, perhaps freshly fished from the bottom of a dirty laundry pile, and had a thick, knotty beard and dreadlocks that scraped at his shoulders. His cheeks looked like shallow, dry lakes, and his skin the pale dust of arid earth. "Hello," he said. "I've been driving for days. I didn't think my car would make it. I'm exhausted. I've come to..." "There's not no flop house," I said. "There are motels a few miles to the south in Port Yuga and a little bit to the west in Cross River. I suggest you go to one of those places." "I've come to learn Riverbeat from the master." He shambled forward, a step, two steps. I put my hand in my pocket and thumbed the rough handle of the knife I kept in there on these nights. I wasn't supposed to have the weapon, but self-defense is a human right. There were women and kids here to protect, after all. And if I were Master Didi, I'd steady my core, center my breasts, and prepare my palm to repel him with a slapboxing attack. I'm not the master, though. "Don't step any further," I said. "My little buddy Osiris is weary too, sir." The man pointed to a plump cat at his heels, black with flecks of brown in his fur, a tuft of white beneath his mouth, a golden left eye and a creamy right one. "If you could spare a little kindness," he continued. "The only food I have belongs to this little fellow. I'd appreciate it if you could save me from a fancy feast dinner, at least. Or just provide me with a place to rest my head. Look, my will to learn from Master Didi is strong, but if you all don't see fit to teach me, at least let me rest." "Out of luck, bruh. We out of spaces, and..." I felt a shove at my shoulder that nearly knocked me to the earth. Master Didi's wife pushed me, pushed by me. "Who taught you compassion, Slim?" She placed a hand on the man's shoulder. "I'm sorry about that. Some people can be overprotective. I'm sure you can understand. Follow me. I think we have a guest room available in the basement. You may have to share it with a few others. Is that okay? The man nodded, and the two of them stepped up the stairs, followed by the cat. Now you get settled in, and I'll bring you some rice. Master Didi's not going to be happy about this, I said, and the nagging whine of my voice disgusted even me. She didn't turn. She called, "If Dave has a problem, tell him to come see me." It would be a lie to say I forgot about the kid after a few days passed, but I had trials to prepare for, and he seemed harmless. A bit annoying in the way he did nothing but eat rice, watch us, and walk about with his hands clutched behind his back as if he were a master. After a month or so, he became like a chicken or a cow, part of the farm fauna that served as the backdrop to my life. I didn't befriend the cows or the chickens. I just passed them on my way from here to there, and I could scarcely tell one from another. Late one night, I got off work and walked with tired limbs to meet my band at our practice spot by the pigs. I heard the singing chick's voice from a distance. At first, I thought she was shouting, but as I got closer, I realized she was singing a song I had written. Her destruction of it made my already weary joints ache. She could sing when she wanted to, but tonight, her voice made even the stars ugly. I said nothing to my bandmates, preferring to let my guitar be my greeting as well as my contribution to any conversation. The drummer played something beautiful, and I nestled my sound within his rhythm, and the keyboard coon pressed his fingers to his keys. He stunned me. It truly amazed me the way he could turn any melody into a mediocrity. I rested on the slats of a wooden fence, strumming my guitar, lightning-fingered, hoping my notes could quiet the grunting of the pigs, the grunting of the singing chick, hoping it could turn the keyboard coon into a virtuoso, and then, together with the drummer, strike a hole right through the universe. I felt a tingling, no, a burning at the back of my neck. You know that feeling when someone's watching. I twirled as if the force of a bullet had spun my body. I must have looked a sight. Standing there a little ways off, blank as ever, the kid spied on us. "Don't mind me," he said. "I'm just checking out the sounds." After he finished speaking, he settled into an unbroken gaze. That was his annoying habit, and it repelled me. He had a stare that made you feel dead. "Hey, boy," the singing chick called. "Hey, what do? You play an instrument?" This was an odd thing for the singing chick to ask. Everyone knew the kid did nothing except eat our rice. He didn't sing, didn't play guitar, practice slap boxing, play bass, cook, stand guard, sweep, milk cows, tend pigs. The guy was fucking useless. "Huh? No, I am scat." "You want to sit in with us?" the singing chick asked. "I would love that." "No," I cut in. "You on me on vocals. That's the scheme. We don't need any more vocalists. I can do any scatting we need." "We just practicing," the keyboard coon said. "Stop being so butt tight." "Do I need to remind you of the trials?" I said. "We trying to gel here. We don't need..." "Guys, I don't want to be a bother," the kid said. "I'm just trying to find my place." "Well, it ain't..." Across the way, the sudden rubbery scent of gasoline. It shut my mouth and took my words. As I breathed, the grid of black smoke collected in the back of my throat. We could see it rising in the distance, nearly as well as we could taste it. Someone over by the cows pointed and shouted, "It's the rice people." Me, the band, the kid, we stood solemn. Every time something happened to one of the ruins, it happened to us. A tragedy and a failure in the mission to reclaim the land. The people on that rice farm on the other side of the wildlands traded with us. They had been particularly insular, particularly unfriendly, but I took all squatters among the ruins as a sort of extended family, comrades in this journey. One hadn't burnt in so long. The last fire was before I or any of my bandmates arrived. The threat of flames hung over our fire hazard homes at all times, though. A burning now and then was inevitable. Fucking weirdo, someone said. I didn't look up to see which idiot was speaking. Probably the keyboard coon. It didn't matter. This moment stood taller than my band. Taller even than if we stood on each other's shoulders. It seems like, the kid said slowly, it seems like it's the fate of all the ruins to burn. What kind of shit was that to say? Had the smoke intoxicated him? Did he not believe and believe deeply in the meaning of our existence, of our reclamation? If not, then why was he here? To jinx us? To curse our mission? If the temple burned, I'd have nowhere to rest my head. I had no other home. I wasn't unique in this. This was not at all a game to me. The kid's presence now seemed to me like a harbinger of some coming terribleness. I wanted to pelt him with a rock shower. I glared at the rising smoke. I glared at the kid. I glared at the smoke. I couldn't tell you at the moment which I hated more. Okay, so that's the Temple of Practical Arts. You guys okay? You still there? I can't see. Yeah, you all right? I wasn't requesting applause. I'm not that needy. but thank you for the applause, though. That was nice. Sweet of you. I'm gonna read a very short story. That was only a part of the Temple of Practical Arts. I'm gonna read a very short one in its entirety. This one is called On the Occasion of the Death of Freddie Lee. Now, I wrote this story shortly after the riots in Baltimore, uprising in Baltimore, rather. If you're not familiar with what occurred at that time, a man named Freddie Gray was carrying a legal knife, and he was harassed by the police, and he decided to run instead of being harassed, and they arrested him and put him in a van and didn't properly secure him, and they drove him around roughly, and ended with his spine being severed, and he died in that van, It was something that really angered me. It took place not very far from where I lived, and it was a situation in which I knew at the moment that no one would receive any punishment for it, and no one did, and you know it sort of exposed years and years and years of police abuse, harassment of people in West Baltimore. And so at that moment, I was part of an art exhibit called Call and Response, in which there was an artist, and then writers would write something in response to the artist, or rather the artist would write something, and the artist would create something. And this year they brought in food, so there was supposed to be a tasting. And the food and the art and the writers would all, you know, combine and create something. And the tasting happened actually. It was actually right after the riots ended. It was so close to the end of the riots that I thought, you know, it would have to be canceled and rescheduled. But the riots subsided, and I was still angry. And when I got there. It was some rice that we were tasting, and it had like a smoky taste, and there was beef in it. It was really, really good, but I thought, oh, this is, you know, it, you know, the smoky taste of the food reminded me of the, you know, the smoke of the, you know, that was in the streets, and I thought, oh, this is my moment to write something angry and incendiary. I was gonna write the literary equivalent of NWA's Fuck the Police. I went home and, you know, did, what I wrote didn't turn out to be that type of piece, and that's fine. But this was, that was the origin and the, of the story. I think I have a whole career to write the literary equivalent of Fuck the Police. So hopefully that happens eventually. But so I borrowed the gentleman's name a little bit for the title, and this is the story. Early one morning in the turgid, musty swamp, Freddie Lee collapsed amongst the rice and the brown water, a result of working his body like a machine. Both John Henry, the steel driving man, and the locomotive at the same time. He so loved the work, he battled himself to fill basket after endless basket with rice stalks, and as a reward, he fell face down into the crops before any of us woke. We all labored next to his body as we were told to do, coming to view his dead form with a reverence. Freddie Lee was no longer a man, no longer our friend, but instead an offering to God made to lie out there until Papa Troy gave word. And each night, we burned the stalks we picked from around him. But something kept getting to me out in the sun, something beyond the stench, something that rearranged my mind. Man, every time I drew near the eternally slumbering Freddie Lee and his decaying face. I remember when Mama Yona died, and we all gathered solemnly for 6 hours as we put her into the earth, and Papa Troy spoke of his life, of their life together, building this new world away from the world, away from cars, away from TVs, away from balloons and DVDs, away from it all, at this rice farm in the ruins of a plantation on a wildlands hill. The children planted a tree over her resting place, and it felt beautiful and unreal, as if we existed on a spinning disc covered by a magical dome. Anything could happen here. Freddie Lee believed in this life with the entirety of his, unbeknownst to him, dying heart. Working the watery fields after my friend passed, I didn't become deranged, but found myself somewhere close to it. Something resembling a dark shadow spreading like an ink blot over my brain. I had obeyed dutifully following after Freddie Lee. I wondered if I'd share his fate, lying among the rice and the muck with a crumbling forever stare. And I could have probably taken it, inky brain and all, had I not seen that blasted cow, Lanier, tearing at Freddie Lee's face, ripping, chewing his flesh like fresh grass. I waved my arms and yelled, charged the beast while screaming. But her tail swatted at flies, and the rest of the animal paid me no mind. The chewed face of Freddy, Papa Troy told us, is just how it's supposed to be. Me and Luke and little Uni went out that night to move the body from the shallow waters, but Mama's thug riders, that's what they call themselves, rode in silently on their horses, at least I didn't hear them, and waved their whips at us, opening up raw wounds on our chests and backs. When we returned to our cabin, we listened to the breeze whistle through the cracks and we tended to each other's wounds. I watched the great house with its light and its mirth. I was sure the drinks flowed there like the river water we diverted over the land to feed the rice stalks. Papa was having a party. There was always a party and we were the eternally uninvited, unless someone important wanted a piece of our souls. Papa says everyone is equal, Luke said. Some people are little Uni said, kissing his lips. I watched them make love. They soon crumpled to the floor, exhausted and sated as they were taught to be. Did you see Freddie Lee's body, I asked. John Henry, the rice harvesting man? If he died harvesting rice for the love of us all, then why, even before that damn cow got to him, why was he all broken and bruised? Shh, little Uni said. But she had no energy to sate me, and before I could ask about the expelled, whether our friend was close to them, as the whispers implied, we all fell one by one into dazed and dizzying fever dreams. I wonder who's the first to speak of the flames in our sleep murmurs. Did we all share the same nightmares? Morning came. The sun rose hot over the damp fields, and we were once again the docile supplicants of Mama Yona and Papa Troy's mercy, picking rice around our friend. Poor Freddie Lee, his face skeletal, except for those swollen, staring eyes. He deserved more than the tepid love of cowards. It might have ended right there had Freddie Lee not risen from the dead to rip the cow into thousands of pieces. That morning, Papa had planned to announce his next queen. Could have been any of us. But we woke to bits of bloody cow meat everywhere, smeared on the windows of the great house, clinging to the rice stalks. Papa postponed his announcement and called for us to give up any information we had on the whereabouts of Freddie Lee's body and the circumstances of the cow's death. Some pointed their fingers at the three of us, but we pointed ours right back. If it were us, I said, wouldn't we be stained? Marked like we took a bath in cow's blood? My logic silenced our accusers. For 3 hours, Papa Troy stood on the porch of the great house discussing betrayal and the life of his beloved Lanier. Tears soaked into his beard, his voice as watery as the rice fields. Our hearts broke, but who are we to ramble madly about what we knew, what we saw? The dead man sauntering smoothly, coolly until he spotted the cow. He stopped and threw his head back, wailing silently. The cow had long ripped his tongue from his mouth. His raw face and his perfect eyes bathed in the light of the moon. I called his name, but he watched us as if we were merely curiosities to ponder and then ignore. He stared for several seconds before he did his violence. I stayed up many nights afterward to catch another glimpse of Freddie Lee, but I never saw him again. Every once in a while, I'd ask Luke or Little Uni if we saw what we really saw, and they'd nod like walking corpses without tongues. One evening, when the passing of the months had given us no ease from the thug riders and their whippings, Little Uni and I stood near the farthest edge of the farm. Did we really see what we saw? I asked again. You know, with Freddie. Shh, she said. Shh. She pointed to Luke walking towards us, a bundle of stalks in his arms. Behind him, flames had begun dancing along the rice fields. Fires even tap danced upon the face of the waters below. The only world we knew was now shrouded in clouds and black smoke. I watched Luke's rice and breathed in his fumes. He stank of gasoline. Little Uni sighed. Luke cursed. Dumped the day's haul to the wet ground. Little Uni lit a match. Thank you.